يقول رجع عفوي رب سامعي محمد بن الجزري الشافعي. الحمد لله وصلى الله على نبيه ومصطفاه محمد وآله وصحبه ومقرئ القرآن مع محبه. وبعد، إن هذه مقدمة فيما على قارئه أن يعلمه، إذ واجب عليهم محتم قبل الشروع أولا أن يعلموا مخارج الحروف والصفات ليلفظوا بأفصح اللغات محرر التجويد والمواقف وما الذي رسم في المصاحف.
رب العالمين، وأفضل الصلاة والتسليم على سيدنا محمد رسول رب العالمين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما وعملا متقبلا يا أرحم الراحمين. O Allah, teach us what benefit us, increase us in knowledge, in good morals and in good deeds, ya Rabbil Alameen. We continue by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's blessings in explaining منظومة المقدمة فيما يجب على قارئ القرآن أن يعلمه من نظم إمام الحفاظ وحجة القراء محمد بن محمد بن محمد بن علي بن يوسف بن الجزري رحمه الله تعالى. And very quickly, inshallah, important reminders before we go on. بتأشير. MashaAllah, I'm happy with Hannah that she has a guest coming over, and instead of losing the class, she brought the guest with her, right? And this is, guys, what you should do, because many times, Allah, why you did not come? Allah, I have a guest. Okay, bring the guest and benefit this hour, and you will, inshallah, you will get the reward, and he or she will benefit, right? So this is something good that we should mention. Barakallahu. Inshallah, today or tomorrow, I think we started the new Hijri year. And two quick points here that we should remind you about, that make this as a chance for evaluation. What have you done in the past, in this past year? What are the things that were wrong? What are the things that you should get rid of? Those bad habits, those sins that you're insisting on. For example, I'm saying for example, every one of us have mistakes, right? Have issues that we should get rid of. If you are not always in an attempt to improve yourself, then you should know that you're on the wrong way, that you have reached ignorance. So always you have to work on improving yourself, on getting rid of some bad habits. So this is the new Hijri year is a good chance for you to reflect on the past year and to, inshallah, to open a new chapter in your life, in your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with your family members, with your neighbors, with your friends, to open a new chapter and plan to have, inshallah, a better year, so that, inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bless you and will admit you into His pleasure and His paradise. The second thing is the hijrah. We should never ever forget this major incident in our history. This incident that the Sahaba chose by consensus to make it the beginning of our history, right, is the migration. So it's a good chance also to spend today or tomorrow, read the story of the hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or watch one of the videos. I made many, many khutbas and many talks about the hijrah. And honestly, wallahi, if we spend one whole month of classes about the hijrah, it won't be enough. Because this is an amazing and a very well planned journey that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam took. It was not a chaotic move. It was very well planned, and he planned for it for many years. It was not just like 1 year, you know. And the proof is when he arrived in Al-Madina, they were waiting for him, and they welcomed him with Tala al-Badru alayna min thaniyat al-Wada', right? And they were almost all of the houses of Al-Madinah already embraced Islam or heard about Islam. So he sent some people ahead and they were teaching people the Quran, etc., etc. So read Al-Hijrah, read about the migration of the Prophet ﷺ and learn what you have to get of the Hijrah and what is your portion of the Hijrah. Now there's no more Hijrah from Mecca to Al-Madinah, right? But there are many types of Hijrah. So yesterday in the khutbah, I mentioned some of those points. You can watch it, it's about 25 minutes, inshallah, and that will give you, inshallah, some of the rewards of the Hijrah. I'll give you one, because I'm not very optimistic that all of you will watch. So I'll give you one meaning of the Hijrah. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for example, al-ibadatu fil hajj ka hijratin ilayya. Worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the times of tribulations and trials and difficulties is like a migration to me. So you will get a reward, the reward of migration, when you persist on your worship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the time of Hajj, this is the time of difficulty, the time of trials, the time of where people are drowned in sins and mistakes and errors, and when things are turned upside down, right? When immorality became like a norm, right? So in this time, when you were turning away from all those sins and all those mistakes that people are drowned in, and you persist in your faith, on your iman, on your worship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, on preserving your chastity, preserving your morality, preserving your modesty, when you're doing that, the sisters, when you're maintaining your hijab, maintaining your covering, maintaining the conditions of the clothing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded you, that is a great struggle. Inshallah, Allah will reward you for it and give you the reward of hijrah. Same thing with the boys, when you see your friends vaping or smoking or weeding, or is that a verb? So, and you see them drowned in friendship with girls, and so those things, when you turn away from that and you persist in your commitment to your religion, that is inshallah, that is something, that is a type of hijrah, because hijrah in the Arabic language is to desert something. Hajara means deserted, to leave something, to desert something. And finally, after the best of fasting after Ramadan is the fasting in this month, Shahrullah al-Muharram, the month of Allah, the sacred month of Allah, which is al-Muharram. The best fasting after Ramadan is fasting in this month. So try to do that also, at least once a week or twice, and that also will help you improve, inshallah, and purify yourself and improve in your spirit. The qira'at, we were talking about the qira'at of the Quran, and all of these topics are about the verse of Imam Ibn al-Jazari, in which he says, which is 28 I think, in which he says what? He said, وَالْأَخْذُ بِالتَّجْوِيدِ حَتْمٌ لَازِمٌ مَنْ لَمْ يُصَحِّحِ الْقُرَانَ آثِمُ لِأَنَّهُ بِهِ الْإِلَهُ أَنْزَلَ وَهَكَذَا مِنْهُ إِلَيْنَا وَصَلَ. He's saying taking or implementing tajweed is necessary and mandatory, because the one who does not correct his recitation of the Quran is a sinner, and we explain that in details. Then he said, because the matter is بِهِ الْإِلَهُ أَنْزَلَ, that God revealed it with it. Revealed what? Revealed what? If you know, say aloud. Revealed what? The Quran. With it, with what? With tajweed. لِأَنَّهُ بِهِ, with it, الْإِلَهُ أَنْزَلَ, revealed it. وَهَكَذَا, and thus, مِنْهُ إِلَيْنَا وَصَلَ, it reached us from him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Means it reached us with tajweed. This is, you have to read it, this is why you have to read it as it was revealed and as it reached us without any change. And we were talking about the written preservation of the Quran and the oral preservation of the Quran. or the oral transmission and the written transmission. And we said the main reliance, and this is one of the questions, huh? The main reliance for us as Muslims in preserving the Quran is what? The oral transmission. We don't care now if they tell us, ah, we found a manuscript from the time of the Sahaba. Ah, but look, it has differences. We don't believe them, right? And we don't care. Because then some devils in this world, they do certain things. So don't be deceived by like, ah, the university of so-and-so, they found something. For your information, about evolution, some of these devils, what they did, they faked some of the human skulls, and they put them somewhere in some of the deserts in Africa or somewhere, and then they made a big announcement that we found skulls, and they said, oh look, it's similar to the monkeys. Okay, if you want to believe you came from the monkeys or developed from the monkeys, it's up to you. But for us, it doesn't work. So even in the field of science, some of these people, they're making up things. But for us, we only follow the facts. We only follow certainty. For us, the Holy Quran is preserved orally, not only in a written way. But even in the written way, it is preserved. Even in the written way, it is preserved. And this copy that every one of us read from, it is the exact same letters, not the dots and the harakat, the exact same letters that, as we will see today, inshallah, that were written in the presence of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam 1400 years ago. We reached the second compilation of the Quran, which was in the time of Sayyidina Uthman radiallahu anhu. And we said, before we get into how Sayyidina Uthman compiled it and what he did, because he did something extra from what Sayyidina Abu Bakr did in his time. Before we understand this extra thing, we have to understand al-qira'at of the Quran, or to be more correct, al-ahruf al-sab'a of the Quran. And what are those ahruf al-sab'a, the seven ahruf? They are not the seven qira'at, as some people mistakenly think. And they are not the ten qira'at. Al-ahruf al-sab'a are what? This is what we stopped at. And again, we're talking about the Hijra, in which we found a great example of the Prophet ﷺ's sacrifice and his mercy towards his Ummah, and how he abandoned everything, and he abandoned all the worldly things that they offered him, and he preferred and he insisted to convey the message of Islam. The Qira'at also shows his mercy ﷺ towards his Ummah. When Sayyidina Jibreel alayhi salam came to him, as in the hadith narrated by Imam Abu Ya'la. No, not this hadith by Imam Abu Ya'la. In the authentic hadith, when he sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when Sayyidina Jibreel came to him and told him, Allah commands you to read the Quran to your ummah in one way, in one harf. Then he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, my ummah cannot bear that. Because the Arabs are many tribes, and every tribe, your sister, has different dialect. So it's different now, just like now, if you want Australians and Canadians and British people and American people, all of them, you want them to speak the American accent. It's difficult for them. Or you want them to speak the Australian English. It's difficult for them, right? Right? Even though it's one language. Same thing our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked Sayyidina Jibreel to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that this is difficult for my ummah. So he kept asking him until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him the permittance and revealed the Quran to him on seven ahruf. Within seven ahruf. What are those seven ahruf? We're gonna explain. But the point is, he told him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told, Sayyidina Jibreel told him, and Allah will give you with every request a prayer that you can make. وَلَكَ بِكُلِّ رَدَّةٍ دَعْوَةٍ. Every time Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked Sayyidina Jibreel to make it easy for the ummah and give him more options or more permittance or more ways to read the Quran. Allah gave him as a gift for him a dua that he will answer. So he got three dua or three adaya, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What he's gonna do? What is he going to pray, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? How he's gonna use, how he used those dua? He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allahumma ghafir li ummati. Oh Allah, forgive my ummah. Sallallahu alayka ya Sayyidi ya Rasulullah. That was the first da'wah. The second du'a, he said, Allahumma ghafir li ummati. Oh Allah, forgive my ummah. See this amazing Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how much you should love him? More than your own soul, you should love him. Allah gave, he asked permittance and ease for his ummah. And he got a gift from Allah and he used that gift again for his ummah. What about the third dua? He said, I kept it for my ummah for the day of judgment when they need it most. Allahu Akbar. Sallallahu alayka ya Sayyidi ya Rasulullah. So you see the mercy, the Prophet's mercy, how it manifests itself in the qira'at and how he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this is the hadith narrated by Imam Muslim. And this is how Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explains to Sayyidina Ubay. So let me read the hadith for you again, also to see the how Sayyidina Ubay radiallahu anhu, in the beginning, he was surprised with that. Imam Muslim narrates from Sayyidina Ubay radiallahu anhu, he said, I entered the masjid and I found a man reading in a way that I was surprised at. Right, sister? He said he was reading in a way that I was surprised at. فَأَنْكَرْتُهَا عَلَيْهِ I rejected that way. Why? Because they knew it was fixed in their mind that the Quran should be read how? The same way we got it from the Prophet ﷺ. And look here, he's not talking about like this person was giving a different tafsir. No, no. He's speaking about what? A different way of reading the Quran, right? He said, then another man entered and he read even in a way that is different from the other man. So now how many qira'at we had in that incident? Three qira'at, three different qira'at. And he said, when we finished the prayer, we all went to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. See why in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they did not need to compile the Quran? Because the reference, the source of the Quran is there, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Or the one who transmitted the Quran from Allah is there. So any difference, they run to him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he said, Ya Rasulullah, this person, he told him the story. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told them, read. So both of them read. فَحَسَّنَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهُ وَسَلَّمَ شَأْنَهُمَا. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam approved both of them. Sayyidina Ubay said, I had a lot of whisperings in my, like a whisperings of denial in my heart. I had a whisperings of denial in my heart. How? The Prophet taught me this way, then now he's saying that they are also right. فَلَمَّا رَأَى رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. Look at the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, the mercy, the gifted mercy. Look at the physician of the hearts, صلى الله عليه وسلم. And the physician of the bodies, and the physician of the soul. Look what the narrator says. Sayyidina Ubay said, فَلَمَّا رَأَى مَا غَشِيَنِي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ felt right away. When he was looking at him, he felt that he had that problem. فَضَرَبَ فِي صَدْرِي صلى الله عليه وسلم. Right away, he transferred the spiritual power. فَضَرَبَ فِي صَدْرِي فَفِضْتُ عَرَقًا. I sweated right away. I started sweating. وَكَأَنَّمَا أَنظُرُ إِلَى اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. As if I'm meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Out of fear. That's in Sahih Muslim, authentic narration. Then he said, Ya Ubay, Allah sent to me, revealed to me to read the Quran in one way. Then I told, please make it easy for my ummah. So he make it in two ways until he made it in seven ways. And he told me, then he told him the hadith that I told you. That Allah gave him with every request one dua. This shows you the mercy of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This shows you how his smartness, his cleverness, his love, his care, his sallallahu alaihi wasallam. How he right away from looking at Sayyidina Ubay, right away he felt that he had a problem, and how he treated him, how he cured him with his blessed hand, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Just like the person who came to him and he told him, Ya Rasulullah, I like to commit the sin. I like to commit to do the sin with means the means adultery. And how he also treated him with two things, with logic, and he started arguing with him, explaining to him in a logical way, do you like people to do this to your sister? Do you like people to do this to your mother, etc.? Then he cured him in a spiritual way, and he put his hand on his chest, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, until the man left, and he said, the worst thing and the most thing I hate now is that sin that I used to love most. Sallallahu alayhi wa sayyidi Rasulullah. So this is another example. I want to add another example from Imam al-Tabarani, that a man came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he said, Ibn Mas'ud, now to see that in his time he taught those people the different qira'at, is not someone from his own mind read a word according to his own dialect. No. It's by oral transmission again from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This man, he said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Ya Rasulullah, Ibn Mas'ud taught me a surah. See how they're learning oral transmission in a different way from Zayd and in a different way from Ubay. So their readings are different. Whose readings should I follow? What can you learn from this hadith? This man learned from three people. What can you learn from this hadith? That many sahaba learned many qira'at. You understand? Many sahaba learned many qira'at. And one more thing we can learn from this hadith. Who can guess? That in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, many sahaba learned from the other sahaba. Not all the sahaba got the chance to recite the whole Quran or receive the whole Quran from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas did not read the whole Quran to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He did not get the chance to read all of it to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he continued with Sayyidina Zayd or Sayyidina Ubay, some other sahaba, right? And many of the sahaba completed their hifz after the passing away of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and recited the Quran to other sahaba. The point here is, guys, that some sahaba got the whole qira'at. And now this is, keep this in your mind now. We will use this point when we talk how Sayyidina Uthman accommodated all those qira'at in the copies of the Quran that he made. How he accommodated them. The first point to help them do that is that he knew all the qira'at. Sayyidina Uthman and Sayyidina Zayd bin Thabit and Sayyidina Ubay, those three in particular, they knew all the qira'at. And the proof now, go to any ijazah, go to the ijazat in the world and to the asanid of the ijazat, to the sanad of the ijazah. In any qira'ah, you will find Sayyidina Uthman or Zayd or Ubay, one of them, you'll find them there. I reviewed the ijazat of the 10 qira'at. You find Sayyidina Uthman and Sayyidina Zayd and Sayyidina Ubay almost in every qira'ah. Qira'ah of Nafi', qira'ah of Asim, qira'ah of Abu Amr, qira'ah of Hamza. If you go to their asanid and how they got the Quran, you find that they got it from those sahaba. Sayyidina Uthman, Sayyidina Zayd, Sayyidina Ubay, radiyallahu anhum ajma'in. So what did Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say to that man who came to him? He said, Sayyidina Ali was sitting next to him. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not say anything. Since Sayyidina Ali said, لِيَقْرَأْ كُلُّ إِنسَانٍ مِّنْكُمْ كَمَا عُلِّمْ. Let every one of you read as he was taught. And all of that is good and beautiful. This is the word he used. فَإِنَّهُ حَسَنٌ جَمِيلٌ. All of that is beautiful and good. Again, he's setting the rule for us how to get the Quran. How? Let everyone read as he was. What's the word?
Taught.
As you were taught, read it. Not as you look in the Mus'haf. No, as you were taught. And we mentioned many examples how they got this from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And of course, if someone can change from his own mind, like he says, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said the Quran was revealed in 7 ways, so, and this is how my tribe read this word, so I'm going to read it as my tribe. Then, if someone says that or claims that, this means those qira'at are not Quran, because the Quran is from Allah. The Quran has i'jaz, it has miraculous nature. It's Allah's words. No one can say it from his own mind. It has to be transmitted from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And also for the same reason, because they are all from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, no one can come and say, you should not read except in hafiz. No one can say that. That is not permissible to say, because they are all Quran. And argument about the Quran and that those are Quran or not, this is a type of disbelief. Because they are all from the Quran, and we mentioned and we saw how Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam explained that to the Sahaba, and how he cured Sayyidina Ubay from that denial that the Shaytan whispered to him. So he whispered to him. He did not deny. He whispered to him. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam helped him to remove those whisperings away, and he became one of the greatest Qurra of the Quran, not in one qira'ah, in more than one qira'ah. And by the way, that hadith shows him, right? That hadith is a proof that Sayyidina Ubay, he learned about the qira'at, and that pushed him to learn the qira'at. And this is why we find his name in the ijazat of the 10 qira'at, radiyallahu anhu wa Allah. And from those hadith that we mentioned so far, you find that the sahaba's attention and care. We had many incidents, and by the way, I only gave you some hadith, by the way. There are many hadith. How the Sahaba, when they're hearing someone reading in a different way, right away, they don't tolerate it. They don't tolerate that. They right away complain to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that this is not the way we learned. We heard him reading different way. So this shows you and proof above proof that they used to get the Quran from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they did not accept to hear someone reading the Quran in a different way. What are those 7 ahruf that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is talking about? When he said, Sayyidina Abu Ya'la, Al-Hafidh Abu Ya'la in his Musnad, he said that Sayyidina Uthman one day was on the minbar, on the podium, and he said, I ask you by Allah, any person who heard the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying that the Quran was revealed on 7 ahruf, kulluha shafin kafin, and all of them are enough, and all of them are good, and all of them are a cure. He used the word shafin, because the Quran is shifa, a cure. All of them are a cure, and all of them are enough. I ask you by Allah, anyone who heard the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying this, to stand up. It seems in that time, some people started arguing. And that's one of the reasons Sayyidina Uthman will now make the second compilation of the Quran. That's one of the reasons, right, sister? Then many people stood up. فَقَامُوا حَتَّى لَمْ يُحْصَلْ. The narrator is saying, so many people stood that I cannot count them. This shows you what? That this was common among the Sahaba radiallahu anhu. In the beginning, as you notice, Sayyidina Umar didn't know, Sayyidina Ubayd didn't know. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught them, and then this spread until a big number witnessed. And this is why the Imam Abu Ubaid bin Salam, he considered this hadith as a mutawatir, but it is not. Mutawatir, that a huge number of people told it about a huge number. Why it's not mutawatir? Because mutawatir should include a huge number of people in every generation of the chain. So here we have a huge number of the Sahaba, but it seems this narration was not narrated by another huge number. But in total, yes, it is part of our religion that the Quran has been revealed in more than one way. And if someone denies this, he's not a Muslim. If someone denies this fact, he's not a Muslim. Means if we explain to him and we show him the proofs and we show him, then he still denies that's not a Muslim. If someone says, no, only Hafiz, this is the Quran, that Warsh, that's not a Muslim. That makes him out of Islam. So we have to be very careful. What are those ahruf? In order to know the meaning of those ahruf, we have to look at the qira'at that we have today. To know the meanings of those seven ahruf, you have to look at the qira'at that we have today. What are those differences in the qira'at that we have today? If you know those differences, that will lead you to know the meaning of the seven ahruf. If someone says, for example now, the seven ahruf are seven different dialects of the Arabs. What do you think? If someone says the seven ahruf, leave everything and focus here. If someone says the seven ahruf are seven different dialects of the Arab tribes, how can we reply? Can that be correct from what I explained to you about the qira'at? Can that be correct?
No.
Why not?
Because it was from Allah. It was from Allah.
Why not? From Allah, and they're saying this means Allah permitted them and revealed to them to the Prophet ﷺ the Quran in seven different dialects. Why the seven ahruf cannot be the seven dialects, or cannot be seven dialects of the Arabs?
Dialects, what you made up.
Look at the qira'at. Are the qira'at only about dialects? Are the qira'at are only about different dialects? They're not. So the ahruf, seven ahruf, cannot be seven dialects. Did you get it? The qira'at are the result of those seven ahruf. So all the qira'at must be within the frame of those seven ahruf. Did you get it? So they cannot be seven dialects. Why? Because we said there are some qira'at are not about dialect. Arjulikum is different from arjulakum. Bidhanin is different from Bidhanin. These are not dialects. Maliki is not a dialect for another dialect for Maliki. No, these are different words that have different but not contradictory meanings. So it's not only about dialects. Examples. I'll give you two examples before we mention. We're not going to go in details into what are the seven, what are the opinions. The scholars mention about 30 different opinions. Yeah, sister. About, I keep saying, yeah, sister, then I mention by name, huh? Be careful. Seven. There are more than 30 opinions about those ahruf. More than 30 opinions. Different opinions. But I mentioned to you just one of them, which is common. They say these are seven languages of the Arabs. That's not right. I'll give you an example, and I told you why, right? I told you why. Now I'll give you one example. In the time of Sayyiduna, in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and Sayyidina Abu Bakr, and Sayyidina Umar, and Sayyidina Uthman, there were no dots and no harakat. Right? Not even a Hamza, by the way. In Surah Al-Ma'idah, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِذَا قُمْتُمْ إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ فَاغْسِلُوا وُجُوهَكُمْ Look, فَاغْسِلُوا وجوهها وجوهكم right فاغسلوا وجوهكم و وأيديكم أيديكم إلى المرافق وامسحوا وامسحوا برؤو what سيكم right برؤو سيكم و here's the point و أرجو لا أرجلكم right okay that's one قراءة the other قراءة is وأرجلكم وأرجلكم in the time of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and سيدنا أبو بكر and سيدنا عمر and سيدنا عثمان the Quran was written without dots without حركات so this word can be read how can be read وأرجلكم can be read وأرجلكم again why we don't depend on the written transmission the written trans the written copies can be read in many ways this can be read أرجلكم أرجلكم أزجلكم أزحلكم أزخلكم 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 I can read it in 50 ways how did the Sahaba read it they heard it from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم you see the point then later on when more non-Arabs started accepting Islam and the Muslims were afraid that some people would start changing so they invented the dots they invented the harakat in a shape as we will see in a shape or in the form of a dot then they invented the dots themselves then they put signs then they wrote all those differences from the original way in which it was written and they recorded all that so that now we can generate the same exact copy that was written in the presence of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam so for example now in the ten qiraat we find Shu'bah the other narrator of who Asim the common qiraat you're learning is what Hafs from Asim Asim has another very famous student Shu'bah that I read. He reads it with Kasr and Ibn Kathir al-Makki and Hamza al-Kufi and Abu Amr al-Basri. All those Qurra, they read it وَأَرْجُلِكُمْ This is not a dialect. Now what is the difference? Well, if you say وَأَرْجُلَكُمْ In Arabic we have Atuf. You know Atuf? Conjunction. Right? Conjunction. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, when you go to make wudu, when you want to make salah, make the following. Wash, faghsilu means wash. Wash what? Wujuhakum, wash your faces. Wa, and your hands to the elbows, right? Ila al-marafiq. Then he said what? Wamsahu and wipe. Washing different from wiping. If now you want to make wudu and you just wipe like this, and the water doesn't flow, that's not acceptable, wudu, it's invalid. The water should drop, even one drop, in order to be considered washing. So washing different from wiping. Then he said, وَمْسَحُوا and wipe بِرُؤُوسِكُمْ This is why you don't have to wash the head or the hair, right? We just wipe, right? وَمْسَحُوا بِرُؤُوسِكُمْ Wipe your head, and what? If you read it arjulakum, arjulakum, this word is added to masih or to ghasil. Who can tell me? To what? To ghasil. Why? Because when you say arjula, it is similar to wujuha and similar to aydiya. So, as if wamsahu bi ru'usikum, this is an interrupted sentence, this is a sentence that is not related, then he said وَأَرْجُلَكُمْ means فَاغْسِلُوا وُجُوهَكُمْ وَأَيْدِيَكُمْ إِلَى الْمَرَافِقِ وَأَرْجُلَكُمْ then وَمْسَحُوا بِرُؤُوسِكُمْ did you get it? And this is how we do wudu we wash our feet, right? By the way, some Shia, some Muslim sects, they don't wash their feet, they wipe. And they use this ayah as a proof. But the sunnah shows that their action is not right. And this is why we always say it's not enough to depend on the Quran. The sunnah explains the Quran. Anyway, well, but still this is an authentic narration in the Quran. When we say وَأَرْجُلِكُمْ وَأَرْجُلِكُمْ, it is مَعْطُوفَ عَلَىٰ, it's conjunction with or added to or connected with what? With مَسِح or غَسِل. If we say وَأَرْجُلِكُمْ, it's connected with بِرُؤُوسِكُمْ, so it has to be done with مَسِح or with غَسِل. مَسِح. But we don't make مَسِح for the feet. We do غَسِل for the feet. So how can that be another authentic قِرَاءَة? The scholars, they said, this is a proof for wiping when you have leather socks. This is a proof. This is a miracle of the Quran, guys. This is a miracle of the Quran. That one word, is written in one way, but it can be read in more than one way, and those ways are not contradictory, and they all give valid meanings. This is one of the miracles of the Quran. This gives richness in the meaning, but not contradiction. From this, these two qira'at, the scholars concluded what? That you have to wash the feet, and that you can wipe on them if you have leather socks. By agreement, by consensus of the scholars. Did you get it? Did you get that? You understand now? The qira'at, this is only one example. And I explained to you the difference between bidaneen and bidaneen, and how both of them they give two non-contradictory important meanings, etc. So as if they are two ayat and they were compressed in one ayah. As if they are two ayat and compressed in one ayah, this is another aspect of the miraculous nature of the Holy Quran. Does anyone know any book in the world that can be read in more than one way, that are not contradictory and written in the same way? So this is an example of the qira'at. So as we mentioned, the main reason for the qira'at is not only to make it easy, is to make it easy for the ummah, but subhanallah, as I told you this before, I don't know, maybe I read this somewhere, maybe from my online, but this is a fact that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked that Allah makes it easy for the ummah, and Allah did not only give him that, he gave him another thing, he gave him another gift, which is the other type of the qira'at. So he did not only allow him or reveal to him the Quran in more than one dialect, he also gave him like a bonus, if you like, which is that some of the ayat are read in more than one way, to give him more than one meaning and to give him variety in the meanings. And to give also, to give rahmah for the ummah. Wiping on the leather socks is rahmah also for the ummah, is mercy for the ummah, right? Especially in winter and you're cold, and so you just wipe on the leather socks. But the normal socks, don't wipe on the normal socks unless you learn the conditions for that. Don't just copy people and just any socks, any time, any condition. There are conditions for the socks and condition for how you made wudu before the socks, etc. So that you can wipe on the socks. If you want to know, you can ask me after the class. So, what are those seven ahruf there? Imam Abu al-Fadl al-Razi and Ibn Qutaybah, these two scholars, they were the ones that I think, and Sheikh Zulqani thinks in his Marahil al-Arfan, which is the most adopted book in the sciences of the Quran, and so many scholars prefer this opinion, which is what? That those seven ahruf mean that any difference in the in the Quran or in the Qira'at comes under 7 categories of differences. That so those 7 ahraf are what? Are 7 categories of differences. Did you get that? What are those 7 categories of differences? These scholars, they looked at the Qira'at. They know the Qira'at. They looked, let's see, what are the Qira'at? What are those differences? Number one, they found that we have some words that can be read in singular and can be read in a plural and can be read in dual and can be read with as a masculine or as a feminine. For example, لِأَمَانَاتِهِمْ وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ بِأَمَانَاتِهِمْ وَعَهْدِهِمْ رَاعُونَ, right? How can you read this word? This word can be read لِأَمَانَاتِهِمْ and can be read لِأَمَانَتِهِمْ. What's the difference? أَمَانَتِهِمْ singular, أَمَانَاتِهِمْ plural. So now if I want to go into every example and tell you the difference between these two qira'at and how the meanings are very, very nice and many meanings, it will take us ages. The point is, this is the first difference or category of differences. That some words, of course, not every word in the Quran can be read in all ways, right? Sometimes in the whole page, you find only one word that is different from one qira'ah to another. Sometimes you find 2 words, 3 words, etc. So the point is, these are the categories of differences that are present in some of the words of the Quran. So some words can be read in singular, or dual, or plural. And look at the writing. Can the writing accommodate that? The writing in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, does it accept this type of differences? Yes. It can be read in singular or plural? Yes. So that's number one. That the nouns can be singular, or dual, or plural. The second category is تصريف الأفعال, the conjugation of verbs from present to past to command. Example. I'm giving you examples from the متواتر قراءات. Some scholars, they mention examples of قراءات that are not متواتر. No, we're talking about the متواتر قراءات. Now, if you learn the قراءات, you'll find this. One of those examples. فَقَالُوا رَبَّنَا Surah Saba. What's the ayah? بَيْنَ أَسْفَارِنَا. What's the ayah? رَبَّنَا Ba'id, right? Ba'id. This word, these two words, how can they be read as well? Ba'id means O Allah, Rabbana means O our Rabb. Ba'id bayna asfarina, distance between our travels. Make them separate, make them. So ba'id is in the form of the command, but it's a request, like dua, right? So can this be read as ba'id? Yes, you just put the dagger alif, right? How can it be read as well? It can be read how as well? It can be read what? And this one can be read Rabbana. It can be read also what? Rabbuna. And can be read Ba'ada Baina Asfarina. It turned to be our, here, Rabbana means our Lord. Distance. This is a request. But when you say رَبُّنَا بَعَدَ بَيْنَ أَسْفَارِنَا, which is the قِرَاءَ of Ya'qub, one of the ten Qur'an, Ya'qub al-Basri, it means our Lord distanced between our travels or places, or, which is what? A past tense. So the writing in the time of the Prophet ﷺ accept these two readings? Yes. And this is how Ya'qub got it. From who? He got it from the Sahaba who went to Al-Basra, who learned from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this is the second difference. The second difference. ربنا بعد بين أسفارنا, which is the قراءة of يعقوب. That's the second way. The third way, the difference in إعراب. Who can tell me what إعراب is? We mentioned in the previous classes. إعراب is what? When we said it's haram to change the إعراب in the Quran. What is the إعراب? لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. What's the إعراب? Huh? The changing of the haraka of the last letter in the word based on its position in the sentence. If you say وَإِذِ ابْتَلَى إِبْرَاهِيمُ رَبَّهُ, you made Ibrahim as fa'il, that he tested his Lord, and that's wrong. But it is وَإِذِ ابْتَلَى إِبْرَاهِيمَ رَبُّهُ, that Ibrahim is the object, is the maf'ul bihi, is the one who has been tested by his Lord. So changing from Ibrahim to Ibrahimu, that is the i'rab. In Surah اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وهو الغفور الودود وهو الغفور الودود ذو العرش المجيد فعال. يلا, who can connect for me المجيد وهو الغفور الودود ذو العرش المجيد. He said do. That's possible. What else? Da. Da. That's possible. What else? Di. That's Hafs. Is that Hafs? No. This is Hafs. And this is why I ask you when you're reading, most of you say Dhul Arshi Al-Majidi. So, what's the difference? So this is the difference in I'rab. What is the difference? If you say wahuwa, here wahuwa, right? Wahuwa means Allah. Al-Ghafoor, right? Wahuwa al-Ghafoor al-Wadood. Allah is the most forgiving, the most kind. Dhul Arsh, and He is the possessor of the throne. Okay? Now, Al-Majid. If you say Al-Majidi, then this is an adjective for what? For Allah or for Al-Arsh? For Al-Arsh. This means the Arsh, the throne of Allah, is very glorious, is very magnificent. And that is right. The Arsh, there's nothing greater than the Arsh. And if you say Al-Majidu, which is Hafs narration, and many other Qurra, then this Al-Majidu is a description of Arsh? No, because Arsh Majroor. It must be a description for what? For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah is Al-Majid. Allah is the glorious, is the most great, is the... Right? Did you get that? So that is what, that's another example how. Now here, you see how it gave you how many meanings. Allah is glorious and the most glorious, and the Arsh is glorious and magnificent. Do you see? So that is another example. This is the third category of differences. Do you understand now what the seven Ahruf are? This makes the most sense. That there are seven categories of differences. There will not be any word in the Quran that goes out of these seven categories of differences. And you will not find any word in the Quran that can be read in more than these seven ways, or more than these seven types of differences. So this is when they looked at all the Qur'an, this is what they found. And this is why this is the right opinion, inshallah. And regardless, if this is the meaning of the Ahruf, seven Ahruf or not, okay, we have these 10 qira'at, they are the result. Like these 7 ahruf, if you mix them, the result is these 10 qira'at that we have today, and they are mutawatir, they are transmitted to us through a huge number of people. That cannot be wrong. So that was number what? Number 3, right? Number 4, the difference in addition. So, what is that? Some ayat, in some qira'at, and this is very few, like few words in the whole Quran. The whole Quran has how many words approximately. Anyone has an idea? About 78,000 words in the Quran. About 78,000 words. Among those 78,000 words, we have about 40 words only that are different in meaning. Not in dialect. In dialect we have a lot in meaning, but not contradictory in meaning. In Surah Al-Hadid, وَمَنْ يَتَوَلَّ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ, read the ayah for me, فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الْغَنِيُّ الْحَمِيدُ, right? If you look at, and this is a prominent example that we will see how Sayyidina Uthman accommodated all those qira'at in those qabis. And we will learn also that the qabis that were written in the presence of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the one qabi cannot have all of those categories of differences. In particular, this type of differences. When there's a word in the ayah or a letter that is not present in another qira'ah. Surah Ali Imran, for example. سَارِعُوا إِلَى مَغْفِرَةٍ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ وَجَنَّةٍ, right? No, what is it? Huh? One more time. سَارِعُوا إِلَى مَغْفِرَةٍ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ. Is that right? What is it? It's وَسَارِعُوا. But in Ibn Arabic, it's سَارِعُوا. You understand? So سَارِعُوا has a new sentence. وَسَارِعُوا, it's connected with the previous sentence. Okay? فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الْغَنِيُّ الْحَمِيدُ. This is the qira'ah of all qurra except for الشامي والمدني, Ibn Amir, Nafi' and Abu Ja'far. The qurra of Medina, Nafi' and Abu Ja'far, and the qari of Sham, Ibn Amir, that I read. These three qurra with their six narrators, they read this ayah, وَمَنْ يَتَوَلَّ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ الْغَنِيُّ الْحَمِيدُ. Same meaning, but huwa has more emphasis. This is the fourth category of differences. Now, how Sayyidina Uthman accommodated those qira'at? In one qabi, if he, this is what we're going to explain, if he's going to put here huwa, then he sent this mushaf to Sham, the people of Sham cannot read it, فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ الْغَنِيُّ, because they cannot ignore huwa. And if he doesn't put huwa, and he sent this to Sham, they cannot read فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ, because it's not there. And if, let's say some people said, okay, why doesn't he put in the margin, he said like, keep it here free, and he put here in the margin huwa, or here, then people will get confused, like which one is right. So he didn't do this. What did he do then? That's what we're going to mention next time, inshallah, and see how he accommodated those qira'at in those six copies that he made. So this is the fourth category of differences in the qira'at. Number five, al-ikhtilaf bi taqdim wa ta'khir. A word comes ahead of another word. A word comes ahead of another word. In the other qira'ah, they're switched. For example, فَيَقْتُلُونَ وَيُقْتَلُونَ فَيَقْتُلُونَ وَيُقْتَلُونَ. If you write these two words, just if you change the harakat, they can be read in the opposite way. فَيُقْتَلُونَ وَيَقْتُلُونَ. The first one is they are killed and they are killed by others and they kill others in the battle. If you switch them, you have the opposite meaning. But not a contradictory meaning, because these two things, some people will be killed and some people will kill in the battle, right? So that was number five. Number six, the sixth category is الاختلاف بالإبدال. What does that mean? بالإبدال means only the letters are changed. Some letters are changed. For example, who can read this word? إلى العظام كيف؟ وانظر إلى العظام كيف؟ ننشزها. If you say ننشزها, what if you take this dot away? How do you read it? ننشرها. Both قراءات. Ah, now we know. See, the Muslims, they missed a dot here, so they have this way. They got confused. Is it Nunchizo or Nunchiruha? Because a dot was missing. Oh my God. If you say this, then you're foolish. Because what? Because there were no dots at all. Because there were no dots at all. So why we have only these two qira'at? Because this is how we got them from our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We did not say nat or nath or nas. No. They are very limited words. This is how we got them, right? So this is the second, the sixth category of differences. Finally, who can tell me what is the seventh category? Everyone should know it. What is the seventh category of differences? Is what? The differences in the Qur'an can be one of those six differences. There's another category. What is it?
Pronunciation.
Is the dialect. Is the pronunciation. Is the dialect. The word is written in one way. Wadduha. Is written wadduha. But it can be read wadduha. With taqleel or imara surah or wadduha. Right? That is Ibrahim. Can be read Ibrahim or Ibrahim. Got it? This is why. I'll give you an example. Ibrahim, if you open Surah Al-Baqarah, look how Ibrahim is written, like this. If you look at Surah Al-Baqarah, this is how the word Ibrahim is written. This can be read Ibrahim or Ibrahim, and they put ayah here, a flipped ya. See, the original writing accepts these two dialects. Did you get it? Any questions so far? Any question? صلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم والحمد لله رب العالمين.